My name is Tatiana Ivanova. I'm an employee of the Department of Geology and Hydrobiology of Saint Petersburg University, and I would like to present the main results of our monitoring of stickleback population in the White Sea in our main study area, Kerit Archipelago in Kandalakshi Bay of the White Sea. My presentation contains a discussion about of results about spatial distribution of stickleback in volume, dynamics of density of stickleback in different spawning grounds, and some population characteristics of stickleback, such as age structure and sex ratio. This study based on monitoring based on samples collected in 17 sites. Each site was described with several parameters, such as wave exposure, shore slope in persons, ground type, and as rank scale based on size of bottom sediment. Also, we estimate a plant cover in percent from two main macrophytes of low littoral and upper sublittoral zones. This is eelgrass, Zostera marina, and various species of fucoids. Samples of sticklebacks were collected in summer. This is a period from the end of May to the beginning of September. In the period from 2007 to 2019. The density of stickleback was averaged between years for each site. Samples of stickleback were collected by a small beach stain. We estimate number of stickleback in catch and take sample of fish for study size and age structure and sex ratio and for other parameters. Using these samples, we can estimate density of stickleback in their spawning grounds. This is the inshore zone, not far than 30 meters from coastline. This is the result of classification of our sites with PCA analysis. Stop cutter. This is a PCA analysis, and the main complex of factors dividing sites is the wave exposure and shore slope, and also the size of bottom sediment related with the wave factor. In opposite, the density of eelgrass and stickleback have negative factor loadings in the first component. The second component is density of fucoids that is also almost not correlated with other factors. So we have some sites with dense fucoid thickets and other sites with low density of fucoids. We can divide studied sites into three groups, and we name them as biotopes from 1 to 3. This is this is a picture how look li looks like the first biotope, it always has the eelgrass beds of very high density, so we can also name this biotope as dense eelgrass beds. The second biotope typically has a sandy or muddy sand littoral with fucoids and often sparse eelgrass beds in upper sub littoral. And the third type of coastal biotope is it may be named as rocks, and it has often a significant slope and looks like rocks with literal having big stones. In this picture, shows same correlations between stickleback and macrophytes. We discuss them because macrophytes play an important role in stickleback life. Spawning stickleback usually prefer when there are some macrophytes in the spawning grounds. Plants serve adult stickleback and juveniles as a shelter, defending them from predators, fish or birds. In the White Sea, we have two main types of macrophytes that can make dense thickets in biotopes where sticklebacks spawn. It is eelgrass and various species of fucoids. We study how density of these macrophytes and stickleback depends on some factors such as salinity, slope, and wave exposure. When we compare stickleback and fucoids, we can see that each factor has a different effect on both species. And vice versa, stickleback and eelgrass show a very similar changes in gradients of all three factors. They both are not depend from salinity and can live in a very wide diapason of this factor. They both prefer the same slope of shore, about 5 or 10 centimeters per meter. And both of species like closed inlets with very low wave exposure, and their density decreases strongly with increasing of openness of biotope. So stickleback and eelgrass shows a very similar requirements for environmental conditions, and this is a cause we usually can observe very high densities of eelgrass and spawning stickleback and their juveniles in the same places. So find eelgrass and you'll find stickleback. This is a dynamics of stickleback density on spawning grounds. The dynamics of stickleback density in shore reflects the stages of their life cycles corresponding with spawning. Major sticklebacks appear in shore in the very beginning of June. They always appear suddenly. If yesterday you didn't see anybody, and the next day you can see hundreds of fish per square meter. This, for example, like in this biotope, the spawning lasts about one month, about during whole June. We can find nests during whole June. Since the second half of June, the offshore migration of adult fish begins. And since the second half of July, adult stickleback disappear from inshore biotopes, and we will see them until the next year. The dynamics of adult fish density differs between two spawning biotopes. In the first spawning biotope, dense eel grass beds, we have a noticeable dynamics of stickleback density. In the first half of June, the fish density is maximal, and from 20th of June, density of stickleback decreases. In the second type of spawning biotope, we don't see any significant dynamics of stickleback density during June and the first decade of July. This dynamics has also some methodological consequences. We need our data to be comparable, but often we can't collect all samples in the short period of the maximum density. We don't have problems with samples collected in spawning biotopes of the second type due to the constant density of fish, but for samples from the first biotope, we need to make some correction. In the first half of June, the fish density is maximal and it can be considered as hundreds of persons. And so, if we have samples collected after this period, maximum density, we need to do the corresponding corrections to make density data comparable with other sample pairs. About dynamic of juveniles, it is not shown in this diagram, but I can describe this. The first juveniles appear since the beginning of July and reach their maximum density inshore in the first half of August. And during the August, juveniles growing more than 25 to 30 millimeters migrate offshore. Since the beginning of September, they also disappear from inshore biotopes. No. This is a table with a description of three types of spawning biotopes we can find in study area, and all data about them bullet. They are placed in gradient of wake exposure from low to high. They differ by density of stickleback, both adult and juveniles. We have about hundreds of adult fish and about 1,000 of juveniles per square meter in dense eelgrass beds, the first biotope. Tens of adult and hundreds of juveniles in second type of biotope, coed beds, and absence or very small density of fish in the third type of biotope, the rocks. Rock biotope. Also, as we discussed in the previous picture, these biotopes differ by dynamics of adult and juvenile stickleback. If we compare the distribution and ratio of these biotopes in study area with distribution of spawning stickleback, we can see that dense eelgrass beds have a high positive selectivity and this biotope is very attractive for stickleback. The other two biotopes have a negative selectivity. The second biotope is the most common type of inshore biotopes and is about 70% of shoreline, but it is used by less than half of spawners. And the third biotope, rocks, has a very high negative selectivity close to its minimal value. Most likely this biotope, it is not spawning ground, and stickleback, we can see in these sites, are the migrating fish searching for better places. There are some population characteristics of sticklebacks on spawning grounds, such as body length and weight of males and females. The sex ratio is biased to females and 60 to 70% in average. This is an age structure of mature stickleback. On spawning grounds, we can find sticklebacks from 1 to 5 years old. The most of spawning fish are 2 years old. Also, we have a noticeable amount of one year old fish, both males and females. Fish older than 3 years are very rare. The age structure of females and males is different. We have the larger percent of males among 1 year old fish, and this can indicate that males get mature earlier than females. This is the dynamics of sex ratio in different spawning biotopes. General sex ratio is biased to females during the spawning period, but in the second biotope, in Phocoids, it is close to equal, maybe close to equal. In the end of spawning, the sex ratio in dense eel grass changes when most females live in shore biotopes. A large amount of males remain in spawning grounds, increasing their portion. We don't see this effect in Phocoid biotope. Also, we have some preliminary data of stickleback offshore near the spawning grounds, the third column. Fish, we can say that fish that do not participate in spawning at this moment have also sex ratio biased to females. This is dynamics and differences of age structure between spawning grounds. During the spawning, females in the eel grass beds are younger than in other biotope, in biotope of second type. There are not fish older than 3 years in eel grass. In eel grass, we observed decrease of 1 year old fish and increase of 3 year old fish among both males and females during the spawning periods. And in the biotope, second type of biotope, age structure of spawners doesn't change during the spawning period. We have the age structure of mature fish, so we can't study the immature part of stickleback population because they are absent in shore. For now, they are unreachable for our studies, and sometimes we can find several immature stickleback in our catches, but this is occasional fish that can't represent this part of population. So we underestimate the whole population of stickleback due to underestimating of immature fish. We can reconstruct the amount of immature population using regression equation of mortality. According to this equation, the immature fish are the absolute majority that make 85 or 90% of yellings. Overall ratio of mature and immature stickleback is approximately 1 and 2. So immature amount of immature fish is twice compared with mature fish. About mortality, annual mortality during the second year of life is about 80%, and during the third year is 50%, and 90-100% in the group of older fish. Thank you for your attention.